Ladies and gentlemen, good day and welcome to Gland Pharma Limited Q4 FY21 earnings conference call. As a reminder, all participant lines will be in the listen-only mode, and there will be an opportunity for you to ask questions after the presentation concludes. Should you need assistance during the conference call, please signal an operator by pressing star then zero on your touch-tone phone. Please note that this conference is being recorded. I now hand the conference over to Mr. Sumanta Bajpayee, Vice President, Corporate Finance and Investor Relations. Thank you, and over to you, Mr. Bajpayee.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone, and warm welcome to Gland Pharma's earnings conference call for the fourth quarter and financial year 2021. I have with me Mr. Srinivas Sadu, MD and CEO, Mr. Ravi Mitra, our CFO, to share the business outlook and to answer queries. We will begin the call with opening remarks from management, followed by Q&A session. Before we proceed with the call, please note some of the statements made in today's discussion may be forward-looking, and these must be viewed in conjunction with the risk and uncertainties involved in our business. The safe harbor language contained in our press release also pertains to this conversation. The transcript of this call will be made available in our website shortly. I will now hand over the call to Mr. Sadu for his opening remark. Thank you all. Over to you, Mr. Sadu.
Thank you, Sumanta. Good evening, everyone. Last year has been a challenging year, with the world grappling with numerous unknowns in the wake of the COVID-19 crisis. The health crisis not only impacted human life but also had a widespread impact on the economy. We are in the business of saving lives, and true to this philosophy, our employees exhibited extraordinary dedication to help combat challenges posed by COVID-19. They ensured that we maintain a continuous production and supply of critical medicines. Our ability to respond to changing market demands during COVID-19 was visible, wherein we registered growth in markets of the U.S., Europe, Canada, and Australia, and bulk of new launches and volume growth in existing portfolio, supported by our increased capacity. Our focus on vertical integration strategy in APIs, adding alternate raw material sources, optimizing batch sizes, and streamlining supply chain management have ensured sustained growth even in these tough times where raw material availability was otherwise impacted. We continue to invest in R&D as we believe it is core to building a sustainable business. In FY 2021, total R&D expenditure was 1,220 million, which is nearly 3.5% of our revenue from operations and an increase of 32% over the last year. As on 31st March 2021, we have 284 ANDA filings in the U.S. and 1,501 product registrations globally. We had a good quarter and FY 2021 and continue to move forward on a well-defined strategy. We have shown year-on-year growth of 40% in revenue for the quarter Q4 FY 2021 and 32% for FY 2021. We saw year-on-year growth in PAT of 34% for the quarter Q4 FY 2021 and 29% for the financial year 2021. We have generated INR 6,049 million of cash flow from operations despite inventory buildup from last year-end's level, which was impacted by COVID-19. To be able to deliver such sustained business performance in these challenging times is testimony to our business model and strength of our product portfolio. There were several one-time costs that were incurred during the year on account of COVID-19, yet we managed to rise up to the challenge of absorbing these costs with business growth. Let me take you through the business highlights across various geographies. As highlighted on the last call, our focus on geographic expansion into emerging markets continues, and the new partnerships that we have built over the years are showing sustained demand. Our emerging market business is growing rapidly and has accounted for 16% of our FY 2021 revenue. We have seen 196% year-on-year growth in revenues for the quarter and 136% growth in revenues for the financial year period. We entered new markets like Singapore, Israel, Saudi Arabia, and CIS countries through new partners during this period. Our ability to turn around orders in short period of time and also offer a broad portfolio of products has helped us achieve this phenomenal growth in the financial year 2021. Our key markets, namely U.S., Canada, Europe, and Australia, accounted for 68% of our revenue during FY 2021. We have seen 29% year-on-year growth in revenues for the quarter and 22% growth in revenues for the financial year period. The growth was on account of launch of new products and volume growth in existing products with ramping up of capacities. New launches include products like micafungin and differentiated products like bivalirudin in RTU format, as well as olapatadine ophthalmic product in branded market. We launched 6 molecules during the last quarter. We filed 21 ANDAs and received 32 ANDA approvals during the 12-month period, including our first Penem approval for the U.S. market, Atapenem. We also filed 5 DMFs during the same period. Our domestic market accounts for 16% of our FY21 revenue. We have seen 15% year-on-year growth in revenues for the quarter and 19% growth in revenues for the financial year period. The new capacities being made available for the domestic market has helped ramp up volume growth in the core portfolio of products. We ramped up remdesivir supply and ensured sufficient availability of enoxaparin for the domestic market, considering the requirement for Indian patients. We launched 10 product SKUs in the domestic market during FY21. The reasons for the quarterly changes in gross margins are primarily because of product mix variations and geographic expansion. But when you see the margin profile in an annualized manner, you will not find much difference. Again, I would like to add here that strategically we are trying to diversify our geographical presence by venturing into new markets while maintaining the growth momentum of our key markets of US, Europe, Canada and Australia. As we enter these new markets, we will benefit from higher volumes, resulting in better operational leverage. On the quality and regulatory front, all our plants continue to remain approved by US FDA. Given restrictions on travel on account of COVID-19, customers are conducting audits virtually during this period. I'm confident on the preparedness of our team for any audit virtually or in person. We successfully completed purchase of R&D and manufacturing facility of Vitana Biologics, a biopharmaceutical company located Genome Valley in Hyderabad recently, and are now working towards a seamless operational integration of the assets into Gland, and thereby build on vaccine drug substance manufacturing capability while continuing investment in creating infrastructure for the development and manufacturing of biosimilars. We have entered into an agreement with RDIF to supply Sputnik V's COVID-19 vaccine. Presently, technology transfer process is underway and efforts are to commence production of vaccine by third quarter of fiscal 2022. Learnings and infrastructure support from vaccine business will accelerate our long-term strategy of entering into biosimilar space, well supported by our parent, Fosun Pharma. We are also exploring other M&A opportunities that will help build capabilities to strengthen product and technology infrastructure, such as long-acting injectables, steroidal hormonal products, suspensions, and nasal and inhalation products. We are also looking at niche API suppliers with complementary capabilities, especially in fermentation technology, corticosteroid APIs, and hormonal APIs. We have started investing in our new biologics facility to make it ready for vaccine and our future biosimilar plans. We will be spending about INR 2700 million, including the cost of the facility acquired. In addition to that, our existing capex plan for our formulation and API facilities of nearly INR 3000 million in FY22, INR 2000 million in FY23 is on track. The growth capex will help us in building additional manufacturing capabilities for complex injectables, as well as debottleneck our capacities. As an organization, this year has been transformational, and despite the COVID situation, we have delivered on all key organizational KPIs. Working on the key pillars of focus as laid down at the beginning of the year, we have managed to work on intensive knowledge sharing across our manufacturing facilities. We are going through knowledge building in the vaccine and biosimilar space. We are able to streamline our human capital. It is also important to ensure utmost safety and well-being of employees in these trying times. With new capacities coming online and efficient lifecycle management of products, we continue to maintain our strength in efficient supply chain. We are pleased to inform you that today, Ms. Naina Lal Kidwai and Dr. Alan Zheng have joined our board. Ms. Kidwai is an MBA from Harvard Business School and brings in rich experience in the field of banking and finance. She is recipient of many awards, including the Padma Shri by the Government of India for her contribution to trade and industry. She is presently the chairman of Advent Private Equity India Advisory Board, a non-executive director on the boards of Lafarge Hawkin, Max Financial Services, and Cipla, a trustee of Asia House in the UK, India Advisory Council, member of the US-India Business Council, and was a past president of the Federation of Indian Chamber of Commerce and Industry. She chairs the Financial Services Working Group of the BRICS Business Council and is a member of the Indo-Asian Business Council as well. Dr. Allen is a scientist with rich experience in pharmaceutical research and development and holds more than 21 patent applications and invention disclosures and more than 40 publications and abstracts in peer-reviewed journals to his credit. We are confident that she will play a critical role in setting up strategic direction of organization R&D initiatives. I'm sure that under the able guidance of Ms. Kidwai, Dr. Allen, and other members of our board, Gland Pharma will witness a sustainable growth. We hope to continue delivering strong results for all our stakeholders in the coming year as well. I wish everyone good health. I now hand over the call to our CFO, Mr. Ravi Mitra, who will share some more insights about our financial performance for the quarter and financial year. Thank you very much. Over to you, Mr. Ravi.
Thank you, Mr. Sadhu. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very much for attending our fourth quarter and financial year ending 2021 earnings call. Our earnings presentation has been uploaded on the website. Let me begin with sharing the financial performance of fourth quarter and financial year of 2021. Revenue from operations for the fiscal 21 stood at 34,629 million rupees, a year-on-year increase of 32%. For the fourth quarter, we have reported revenue of rupees 8,877 million, which is a 40% growth year-on-year basis. The key drivers for this growth were increase in volume of existing portfolio, new product launches, and geographic expansion. We have achieved a very good growth across all the markets in the fourth quarter and during the full year. Gross contribution margin for fourth quarter was 56%, and so the full year was at 57%. In spite of the discontinuation of the government MEIS scheme, we were able to maintain healthy gross contribution margin. We have reported an EBITDA of rupees 3,749 million in Q4 FY21 compared to rupees 2,861 million, which is an increase of 31% compared to same period last financial year. EBITDA margin for Q4 FY21 stood at 40% as compared to 42% for the same period of previous financial year. EBITDA for the full year ended March 2021 was at rupees 14,370 million compared to rupees 10,946 million for the previous financial year, a growth of 31%. We have reported EBITDA margin for FY21 at 40%, which is an improvement of 46 basis points as compared to last financial year. We have managed to improve the EBITDA margin despite decrease in gross contribution margin and increase in some of the expenses due to higher operating leverage achieved on increased capacity utilization during the year. Our net profit for fourth quarter was rupees 2,604 million rupees, a growth of 34% compared to quarter four FY20. During the financial year 2021, our PAT was rupees 9,970 million, which is an increase of 29% as compared to last year. We have reported PAT margin for FY21 at 28%, which is in line with last financial year. While there was a one-time gain of deferred tax liability reversal in fiscal 20, the increased volume and resultant operating leverage enabled us to maintain PAT margins. The total R&D expense for the financial year 2021 were rupees 1,220 million compared to rupees 922 million of the previous financial year, which is an increase of 32% and in line with our revenue growth. It stands at 3.5% of the revenue. R&D expense for fourth quarter was 304 million, which is at 3.4% of revenue. Our effective tax rate remains at about 25% in fourth quarter and for the fiscal year 2021. In the previous financial year, the effective tax rate was lower due to one-time reversal of deferred tax liability of rupees 324 million on account of reduction of corporate tax rate in fiscal 20. Cash flow from operation for the 12 months period ended March 31, 2021 was rupees 6,049 million. EBITDA to cash flow from operation conversion has come down during this year compared to previous financial year due to higher inventory on restocking of inventory from the lower level in March 20, when inventory level went down due to initial supply disruption. We have since then restocked our critical inventory requirement considering planned launches and increased demand in the coming months. Cash conversion cycle stood at 229 days for the financial year 2021 as compared to 200 days as of last financial year end. We have improved our receivable days and payable days compared to previous year, but due to increased inventory level, our overall cash conversion cycle has increased. All our planned CapEx plans are progressing well. Total CapEx incurred during the financial year ended March 31, 2021 was rupees 2,288 million used for increasing capacity at our Pashmalaram facility, our new R&D establishment at Pashmalaram, and for routine maintenance CapEx. Our ROCE on ex cash basis as of March 31, 2021 stood at 33%, an improvement of 130 basis points over the previous financial year. Our fixed assets turnover also increased from 2.4 times to 2.8 times as we increased our capacity utilization. As of March 2021, we had total of rupees 30,058 million of cash, which we intend to utilize for CapEx and to fund our organic and inorganic growth strategies. With this, I would now request the moderator to open the lines for questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on the touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one. First question is from the line of Sudarshan Padmanabhan from Sundaram Mutual Fund. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you for taking my question. So my question is on the working capital. As you had earlier, you know, said that this huge increase in the inventory days. I mean, going forward, what should we look at? Should this number kind of normalize, or do you still continue to see issues as far as availability?
Right. So the year end was the inventory for the year end has gone up a bit basis of when we restocked our critical inventory for new launches and the increased demand for especially for products like enoxaparin and heparin. Going forward, if you look at an average basis, this will stabilize. But this is in line with our business model, and we would continue to ensure that enough product is available for meeting our demand.
And sir, my second question is, you know, primarily on, you know, now that we have got, you know, got this Penems in place, and I think, you know, post us getting this vaccine up and running, this plant can also be kind of repurposed to, you know, bio products, which, I mean, our parent has also got a fair amount of capabilities over there. A few things over here, I mean, you know, whatever the amount that we have talked about, the 270 crores investment, incremental, should that be sufficient enough to primarily, you know, set up that capacity, whatever is required for us to supply the 252 million dosage to RDIF? And second is, you know, whether do we need to incrementally invest further into, you know, fermentation process and bios, you know, the biosimilars, or, you know, repurposing this capacity even beyond COVID to basically take our capabilities to the next level?
Yeah, so in terms of vaccine demand of 250 million, you know, this is in line whatever we are investing today to expand our drug substance infrastructure. And also some part of the investment is going into the finished dosage where we have to build the storage facilities because this is minus 18 degree product. So this is this will take care of the supply side of 250 million vaccine doses. Now moving forward into biosimilars, probably 70-80% of this infrastructure will be useful for it. But as you know, and every product has specific requirements in terms of bioreactors or from technology perspective. So there will be add-on investment whenever we get into a development of a biosimilar or we do a tech transfer or something. So the idea is probably 78% is good enough to get into that space. And this will actually trigger our, you know, speeding up our process getting into this, especially on the CDMO side where companies are looking at biosimilar drug substance manufacturing capabilities, and especially with Fosun, our parent company has themselves have the biosimilar capability, so that opportunities will open up.
And how soon can we see this, sir?
Which one, the vaccine?
No, the biosimilar opportunity vaccine. I think we have talked about fourth quarter.
Yeah, so initially the focus is on vaccine first. Till we finish off this project, we don't want to enter the biosimilar space. The initial is to build the capabilities of vaccine and, you know, at least for next 1 year and focus on that and deliver the product what we have entered agreement for.
And just one more final question on the penem. Now that we have etrapenem in place, and I understand that we have a sweet spot given that, you know, we have dedicated capacities that most of the players don't have. Should we be looking at a barrage of penems now, I mean, including guys, I mean, venturing into meropenem and various other penems and make it itself into a separate portfolio?
So meropenem also, we have actually an approved NDA. We looked at a second source to be more competitive. So we're expecting an approval soon. So that will also be launched at later part of this year. So meropenem and etrapenem will be part of our portfolio.
Sure. Thanks a lot. I'll join back.
Thank you. Next question is from the line of Nithya Bala Subramaniam from Bernstein. Please go ahead.
Hi. Congratulations on another good quarter. So a quick question on your U.S. portfolio. So we understand that, again, because of COVID, there were certain products of yours which saw heightened demand, right? Because that's bacterium or inoxaparin, heparin. Would you say that your fourth quarter numbers, these are largely normalized numbers, and this does not include the COVID impact, or are you still seeing heightened demand for these products?
So the COVID demand in the U.S. is kind of normalized, you know, by the second quarter of last year. And like I said in my earlier call, also our portfolio has a larger breadth. While we do get benefit out of COVID-related products, but we also lose some on the other products because of the elective surgeries coming down. Because if you see our portfolio, anti-infectives have come down a bit last year because of this. So overall, you know, we're always able to manage because of the portfolio what we have. So we had some benefit of COVID products in the first quarter of last year, but we also lost some of it because of COVID. But from the second quarter onwards, it kind of normalized. Now there's no impact of COVID in the U.S. It's more in India, but that impact is not in Q4.
Understood. My second question was on China. So I think there are these six products that Fosun has said, which are at various stages of getting an approval. I think three are under QC review, and the others are yet to start QC review. When do you think these products can actually be in the market? What is the approval and the review cycle you're seeing in China right now?
Although we can't give an exact timeline, but the guidance what we're getting is probably 2 years, two products in third or fourth quarter of this year. We'll get our first approval. And then the last quarter of this fiscal, we might get another three products. And that's what the guidance from the regulatory we're getting from China.
So would it be FY20? Can we look at FY23 as a year where China is starting to be a meaningful contributor?
Well, total revenue-wise, it may not be very meaningful, but at least you see some numbers coming in. Some probably FY22 and more in FY23.
Understood. One very quick follow-up on the questions that the previous gentleman had asked. So in terms of the biosimilar opportunity, is your aspiration to be a contract manufacturer, or would you be seriously looking at contract development and manufacturing?
We always started with contract manufacturing, contract development, and they get into our own development. I think that's the path we want to take. We want to dive in quickly into our own development. So this opportunity what we took now is kind of a learning curve for us. And last year, you know, we've been talking to people and they are expressing interest to move biosimilar manufacturing to us. What also we realize is just not the filling people look at, they also look at drug substance manufacturing, because most of the time the bulk stabilities has a limited time and transporting across geographies is difficult. And that also kind of expedites our entry into this arena.
Thank you, Saru. All the best.
Thank you, Nitya.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Saion Mukherjee from Nomura. Please go ahead.
Good evening, sir. Sir, my first question is, you know, we have seen a step up in performance in ROW in this fiscal year. How should we think about that going forward? And secondly, on the US market also, what is the impact of COVID in terms of, lower demand? Is it, can you quantify that number which can potentially come back in next fiscal? For Europe and US put together, your already established markets.
So US is the larger market, Europe is comparatively smaller. So US, you know, I can't put a number, but you know, if you look at the numbers compared to the previous years, like I mentioned with the previous colleagues, anti-infectives has gone down at least for a couple of quarters because of the kind of admissions happening in the hospitals. But you know, we also sold more of some of the anticoagulants and the neuromuscular blocking agents. So overall, the numbers still we could manage because of the portfolio we have. And if you see product like vancomycin, it was on top five products before. It's not anymore, and that's one of the reasons is because of the lesser sales of anti-infectives. So that's one comment I can make, but I can't quantify exactly the impact.
Yeah, and so how should we think about the rest of the world market where we have seen a step up in revenues this year?
That's very intentional. If you see, we had been building up that portfolio and registrations. One was the capacity utilization. We're focusing to give more capacities for the U.S. market. Now that we have built-in capacity from last 3 years, we've been trying to launch our products in these markets. And in a way, COVID also helped us to get to this market quicker than we anticipated, especially markets like Saudi Arabia and Singapore, where the registration timelines are longer. Because of COVID, we could do some emergency supplies and that kind of helped us get through our other products because the site got approved and stuff. So it and moving forward, because of the additional capacities we have installed last 2 to 3 years, we are able to cater to these markets, and that will be a focus area as well to increase geographically, so that both from operational leverage that will help our margins and also de-risk ourselves from dependence on one or two markets.
Okay. So basically, you know, do you think it will be more driven by the growth driven by new markets opening up, or the markets which have already opened up, you would have more products coming in? I mean, what would be the more important driver of growth in the new markets?
It's a combination of both. If you see US, we have grown around 21-20% last year. And the rest of the world is growing faster. And we've always been very strong in South American, Latin markets. And we have a lot of distributors, and the other advantage we got is now currently the partners who are in the U.S., they are spread across the several countries, so they're taking these products also. So you see some of the products going globally, whether it's Pfizer, whether it's Fresenius, they're taking across some of these markets. So that also will add up to the geographic expansion.
Okay, thanks. So the second one is on vaccine and biosimilars. So firstly on vaccine, this 250 million dose contract, to start with, will it be fill and finish only, or it will be, even the first dose, first batches will include the drug substance production at your end?
It's a substance and a fill finished. So the agreement is for substance and fill finish, and that's one reason why we're investing into the substance manufacturing.
Okay.
Okay.
And so the other broader question on biosimilar is like, you mentioned, what's the thought process here, given that, you know, there are large players in Korea, China, et cetera, Gland Pharma is entering into this space, as a new entrant. What would make Gland differentiate in this space? And why do you think, Gland would, succeed in the scaling of this business over a period of time? What does Gland bring to the table, or Fosun brings to the table, to make it a successful business for us?
Yeah, if you look at our business model, that will continue, right? We always partner with people. We don't take products, or we don't get into development unless you have some partnerships, and that model will continue. Like you have started a journey in generics and in the markets, this also will add up to that. The companies, we've been interacting with several companies are looking at outsourcing, the filling, outsourcing the drug substance, and they're also challenging us for just filling, but getting drug substance from them. And with our capabilities and infrastructure and the experience of handling at economical levels, we had that advantage. So the first step is to get into the CDMO kind of a business. Where Fosun also plays a role because of their space, their area, and they are there in the biosimilar space. One thing is looking at the Asian markets and other than the US markets where we can produce here and take to those markets is the first step. And moving forward, the injectable space itself, right? I mean, there's a lot of opportunity in terms of biosimilars and the new molecules are coming at the larger ones. So it's an entry now, and I think moving forward, in 3-4 years down the line, that could be substantial growth prospects for the company.
Okay, so just to clarify, is it likely that Gland Pharma would be doing contract manufacturing for Fosun or its subsidiaries who are in biosimilars? Is that what would be the first stepping stone here?
Well, we are looking at different opportunities. That could be one. But it could be several others as well. So companies are looking at outsourcing these activities, whether it's from the drug substance or the formulation side.
Okay, sir. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Utsav Mehta from Edelweiss Asset Management. Please go ahead.
Hi. Thanks for taking my question. Could you just... If not in too much detail, then at least qualitatively sort of take us through some of the economics of these 250 million doses. How much revenue, how much margins, and what is the investment that is entailed?
The investment part we have already said is about 270 crores investment getting into the substance as of the formulation. We can't really talk about economics on the revenue side.
Okay, but anything in sense of the hurdle rate that you would have considered? So are you basically looking to, let's say, make 15-20% ROC on just this particular investment through the vaccines itself, or are you sort of factoring in the longer term income from these assets?
So we maintain the same level of ROC threshold target when we do any investment. Considering that, even for this new drug substance infrastructure investment, we will continue to have that same kind of IRR expectation.
Okay, understood. And just one simple bookkeeping question. This acquisition that we've made, could you just provide some broad contours in terms of the cost and... I think it's a cash investment, so yeah, in terms of cost.
Yeah, so this happened subsequent to financial year 2021 end. And this is actually an asset purchase. So we have, subsequent to March, we have purchased their facility and the equipment, etc. Total amounting to about 90 crores. On top of it, we are going to invest the balance amount to scale up for the vaccine purpose, which includes bioreactors, storage capacity, etc.
Okay. And the existing facility has bioreactors single-use or multi-use?
It has a single-use bioreactor, but to a certain extent. To get to that the scale of a vaccine, we need to invest into an expansion for the commercial production as well as procure the bioreactors.
Okay, understood. Thank you so much for your time. Those are all my questions.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Pritesh Rathod from Nippon India Mutual Fund. Please go ahead.
Yeah, Ritesh, good evening, everyone. Can you help us? What's the existing capacity you will create in vaccine once the plant is up and running, and you have contracted with RDIF? What you can do with other players? Do you have a empty capacity which can be contacted with other guys on vaccine side?
So currently, the drug substance capacity, what we are building is for 2 million for the year. So that's how the capacity is getting built. And from the finished product side, again, we have allocated 2 manufacturing lines for this, which are dedicated for vaccines. And it may not completely fill the 2 lines, but, probably 70% to 75% it can fill that capacity. If we get an opportunity to fill other vaccines, we'll certainly do.
And what kind of other vaccines you can do fill-finish? Would it be additional? You can also do, in fill-finish, you can do mRNA also?
Yes, it can be done, yes.
Okay. And this contract with RDIF, is it an annual contract? Like every year you have that option, or it's a one-time contract and the second contract will be dependent on how this gets executed? Or the later one?
So the current contract is fixed for 252 million. And it all depends on how the situation will be after that, right?
And it would be, you would be agnostic, like whether it's supplied to India market or exports. Your profitability or your margins will be fixed given your contract is with RDIF, right?
Absolutely. So our product is not dedicated to a market. We have to supply to them and they'll decide where to supply the product. So our pricing and the supply is for, with RDIF.
And that is already fixed, irrespective of whichever geography, whatever pricing they get.
Absolutely.
Okay. Thank you. That's so nice.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Tarang from Old Bridge Capital. Please go ahead. Tarang, may I request you to go ahead and unmute your line from your side?
Hello, sir. Good evening and congratulations for a strong set of numbers. Just wanted to check, what were the export incentives that were not received this year versus the last year?
Yeah, so the export incentive MEIS scheme was there up to August. And from September onwards, we have not received. So total would be about 60 crores.
Okay. So just wanted to check, sir, if I adjust for it, your profitability, the gross margin has actually improved on a year-on-year basis, despite a significant change in your business mix. So from what I understand, the profitability in the developed market, in the emerging markets is maybe lower. So despite that, you've been able to improve your gross margins. If you could comment on that.
So the portfolio, what we're taking to other markets, focusing on products where we have better margins than the normal products. And that's how we started. And if you look at the markets we have grown, like Singapore or Saudi, they are better margin markets. Although we have a large portfolio of products, we are selecting what will keep us in terms of margin profile better than compromising on the margins.
Okay, and how's the competitive intensity in these markets, sir?
Some products, not many players are there. That's one of the reasons. If you see, if you look at the top 10 products in our company, 5 or 6 products, we make our own API. So that kind of gives an advantage in terms of backend integration. And the capacities what we have in terms of facility utilization, capacity utilization, that also is helping us keeping this margin. So it's a mix of backward integration, mix of the output we are giving through manufacturing sites, and also the product mix we are launching in these markets. It's a combination of these which are helping us to keep those margins intact.
Got it. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Tushar Manudhane from Motilal Oswal. Please go ahead.
So just on the, first of all, congrats on a great set of numbers. Just on this Sputnik vaccine, has any of the contract manufacturing companies, there are, 7 to 8 companies who have tied up with RDIF, has any of the companies scaled up to the commercial level production as of now?
I can't really comment because it's still privy to a lot of these companies. But companies have tied up with RDF at different timelines, right? Some have entered agreements end of last year. We have entered only in March. So I would say, of course, not every. Say, and if you see, the companies have tied up are mostly on the bio side, not a real vaccine manufacturing side. And the technology, like everybody is saying, vaccine is not that easy. So, and we need they have to interact with a lot of companies in India and then get their technologies here. So what we hear is people are coming closer to scaling up and getting launched in June, July. But you know, that's a hearsay. So we can't really comment on other companies. But I think we will see soon some manufacturing happening in India.
Okay. Secondly, on the pace of ANDA filing had moderated in 4Q FY21. Any color you would like to give?
Yeah, one is, of course, you know, there is an impact on COVID for at least a month or so because of people attending the duties and all that. Second, the kind of product mix we selected. We talked about getting into the complex generics. So there's a mix of those products also, which has a longer timeline. If you see, we have started working on almost 16, 17 complex injectables. You see some filings happening this year, but two or three will happen this year. So this has a longer development time compared to normal ANDAs. Other than that, there's no particular reason, I would say.
So overall, ANDA filing pace, like, or rather ANDA filing target for FY22, including these complex products?
It will be around 20, similar. And because every year we have a set of complex products, unlike before, so four or five products will be complex, which may take a longer time. So that way, earlier, if you look at our target was about 24, so normal generics, and we're putting some complex mix into that. So our target is 2022, it might fall within that.
And just to complete this, so the overall R&D cost is also expected to increase because we are having more complex products filing?
No, so if you look at percentage-wise, we'll still say it will fall between 3 to 4%. Because they're growing faster, so the absolute number is substantial. If you see the absolute number, we have increased by 30%. So that will take care of the complex, and our model itself is like tying up with companies. So they do take some of the costs of if there is a requirement of bio or clinical. That way we still continue to maintain that 3 to 4% of revenue as R&D expense.
Good. And just lastly, on the operational cost side, like the kind of capex which we are doing. So the rate of increase of the operational cost maybe for next 2 years in terms of employee cost or other expenses, how do we look at it?
Yeah, so going forward, employee cost is going to be in line with the requirement from volume perspective. Other operational cost will not increase in that fashion because there is a leverage bit. You may not need to spend the same amount proportionately as the volume go up because the facility is same and we'll just scale up within the same facility. So we'll get that advantage.
Okay. Thanks. Thanks a lot. That answers my question.
Thank you.
The next question is from Vishal Manchanda from Nirmal Bang Institutional Equities. Please go ahead.
Good evening. Thanks for the opportunity. On Sputnik vaccine, wanted to understand, is the RDIF bound to purchase 250 million doses that they have contracted for?
Yes. Once the technology transfer happens and we can show them the substances available, then they are bound to take the 252 million doses.
And assuming if there is no recurring demand that they have for the vaccine, will you be able to put this facility for an alternative use?
Yeah, so like I said, first is the 252 million is a binding agreement, so they have to take it, and this is not for just one market. They have approvals in over 50 countries, so they have a demand. It's the question of supply now. From alternate post this, if there is an extension of requirement, because still nobody knows whether it's annual demand, everybody has to vaccinate every year. It's not clear yet.
So if COVID goes away, this facility can be used for biospace. Like I said, probably 15% of this is specific to this particular vaccine, but the rest can be utilized for other products.
Even other vaccines and other biosimilar products.
Other biosimilars, yeah, correct.
And was there any contribution of Remdesivir during the quarter, or all of that will come in the next financial year?
So during the quarter, Q4 it is not much, but Q3 yes. And then after
previous
quarter, and then in this current April to June, you will see the impact.
Okay. And just one more on the Sputnik vaccine. So you would be incrementally investing 270 crores, but that does not include the fill and finish facility, because you already have that in place.
Correct. So we are going to add on, we're going to spend some amount into that, about 30-40 crores, to add capabilities to fill in terms of storage specifically, because it has to be almost a 20-25 day stock has to be maintained at the site before you get an approval. So some investments are going at the fill finish, but mostly at the substance level.
Okay. And will there be a large expansion in employee costs to support this vaccine production?
No, it's not going to be substantial employee cost in that.
Okay. Thanks very much. That's all from my side.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Amey Chalke from Haitong Securities. Please go ahead.
Thanks for taking my question, and congratulations to management for the good set of numbers. Most of the questions are answered, but just I have a follow-up question on vaccines. Sir, one of the partner with RDF has said that they are doing clinical trials for which they are manufacturing those vaccines in India. So do we also have to do clinical trials before we launch this product in India? And the second question I have is on the peptides. If you can highlight where we are in terms of filing these products and also the manufacturing capabilities, because I believe we were looking for peptide API companies a few months back. So where are we in terms of manufacturing capabilities in this category? Yes, thank you.
Yeah, so from the vaccine side, from our perspective, I know which company you're referring to. So unless you sell in Indian market, do not do a clinical study here. They're expecting a bridging study if it's in the site. But that's not going to come under our purview. Our agreement is to give the finished product to RDIF, and they'll decide where to sell it. And if they want to sell the product in India, then whoever is marketing or however they want to do, they have to do the bridging study. We are not responsible for that. That's on the vaccine. From the peptide side, yeah, we, like I just mentioned before this call, we're working on some of the complex products, including some peptides and some hormonal products and some suspensions. So one of the peptides, complex peptides, is expected to be filed this year. And next year, there'll be a couple more. On the API acquisition front, yeah, we are looking at some of the manufacturing development sites. But as of now, nothing concrete yet on this side.
Sure, sir. Thank you for answering my question. Just last bookkeeping question on the other income, because for last two quarters, our other income has been similar to what we used to report before the IPO. So just wanted to know, like, how it will move up since we are sitting on around 3,000 crore cash for next 2 years. Thank you so much.
Yeah, so other income is largely constituting interest on the fixed deposits, our treasury, and the foreign exchange on our operations. So going forward, this cash will continue to earn this kind of other income till we utilize that for any M&A or large investments.
Sir, and any strategy on the dividend side, if you want to highlight?
So we are a high growth company, and at this point of time, board has decided to reinvest into the business. So based on board's decision in the future, the dividend will be decided.
Sure, sir. Thank you so much for taking my question.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Ankush Agarwal from Raipur Capital. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. Thank you for taking my question, sir. Firstly, on the biosimilar business, what kind of business model are we targeting? Are we looking to develop our own IP, given that it's a very long timeline that is required to develop the IP over here and the cost involved are also higher, or it would be largely a CMO operation that we will be looking at?
To start with, it's largely a CMO or CDMO kind of business we're looking at from biosimilar side.
Okay, got it. And so secondly, any update on the inorganic opportunity that we are targeting, specifically the restricted substance in the U.S.?
Not in the U.S., not on that area yet. What I said, now, because of COVID, there are some limitations in terms of M&A in some geographies. But we are looking at keenly at M&A, some of the M&A opportunities in Europe. But other than that, we can't comment much.
So the European opportunities are related to like expanding the manufacturing infrastructure, or it would be like expanding the geography or the product portfolio that we can't do in India?
Yeah, it's more into the it's a combination of product portfolio and capabilities in terms of manufacturing, which we don't have.
Oh, okay. Got it. That would be all. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Jigar Walia from OHM Group. Please go ahead.
Yeah, my question is slightly on the similar lines of the prior one. In terms of biologics, we'll be looking at vaccines, mAbs, peptides, or also we'll look at proteins, excipients, or similar. And to what extent the capacities can be fungible?
Can you repeat that? I lost it in the end. It's not very
clear. So my question is, we'll be on the biologic side, we'll look at vaccines, mAbs, peptide products, or we'll also look at proteins or excipients or products like that.
Yeah, to start with the vaccines, mAbs, and some peptides, and then we can get into other stuff. But primarily, we're looking at these areas.
Primarily these, and to and what capacity is generally be fungible when it is, or for products like peptides, etc., there will be a dedicated separate business required.
Some might need some additional equipment and some reactors, but otherwise most of it can be fungible.
Understood. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Vikas Mistry from Moonshot Ventures. Please go ahead.
Hello. Congrats, yes, sir, on good set of numbers. Actually, sir, I want to ask questions again on biologics. What is your vision for next 5 years, whether you will be doing some stepping some cell lines and all that? And what is the capacity of kiloliters you are thinking in terms of establishing?
We're just now, you know, we're just entering it. So the first step is, of course, vaccine. We're going up to 1 KL, I would say.
Okay.
And then we'll get into the other areas and then understand the demand and the technology. You know, it all depends on the drug substance technology as well. Like I said, our idea is to enter into CMO kind of a business, CMO, CDMO. Mm-hmm. And that will dictate what kind of reactors we need getting into that business.
Okay. One more question on top 20% of what is your revenue contribution from your top 20 or 10% of molecules?
Our top 10 molecules contribute about 57% of business, yeah. At a company level, yeah.
Okay, sir, do you understand that kind of growth you're showing? Is your CapEx in line with this kind of growth to sustain for a good amount of time?
Yes, if you see last 3 years, we've been investing into capacities for, you know, I would say till 24, 25, that's where we've been investing into. And as we speak, even the site where we are filling, we want to fill the vaccine, that still has capacity to add more lines. And in injectables, like I always said, almost 85, 90% is fixed cost. You need to have a site and the suites ready. And add-on lines might require some capex, but it's not huge compared to building a site. So, yeah, we're good enough for a few years.
Sir, last question from my side. What is the volume and value in terms of growth? Can you break down for me?
Yeah, if you look at the 32% growth for the last year, about 14% came from new launches, 9% from volume, and 7% from value, price.
Thanks a lot. Congrats, sir, again, for a good set of numbers. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Ankush from Access Securities. Please go ahead.
Yeah, so congrats, sir, for good set of numbers. Sir, I just want to understand, last year we have launched 46 new products in the core markets. And with the launch of these new products and expansion in the emerging markets, the kind of a growth is there. So what is the target for the new products for this FY22? And which will the strategy for this emerging market? And can I get us some more sense in which category that we are going to launch all these new products in this year, like dermatology, oncology, diabetes, something like that?
So we don't go by the therapeutic area. If you look at the FY22, there are almost 62 SKUs planning to be launched, and which is about 36 molecules. The quarter one, the plan is to launch about 10 molecules, and quarter two about 9. And if you look at our approvals, we already have approvals for many of those. And if you see the last quarter, Q4, we had, give me a second, how many approvals? We had 8 approvals in Q4, and so we have a pipeline of products we need to be launched, and also several tentatively approved products which will be launched in second quarter. So we have a robust pipeline to get launched in this year as well, FY22.
So we are looking for 62 SKUs.
SKU, 62 SKUs. But if you go by molecule wise, in 6 months it's about 20 molecules we'll be launching.
Yeah, thank you, sir. That's from my
yeah.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Ritika Agarwal from ValueQuest Investments. Please go ahead.
Hi, good evening, sir. So first question on EBITDA margin. We saw good expansion in this year. What is your sense on further improvement from here on in the medium term?
So we cannot really give a guidance on that matter, but we will continue to maintain the kind of EBITDA margin we are doing.
Okay. Secondly, on US segment, apart from ertapenem, do we see any other important high-value launches for the company in FY22? Anything that we want to call out on?
Some of the products what we launched last year have to be annualized as well. If you look at mycofungin, which we launched last year, it's the numbers are looking good. We are the only ones there. And most of the contracts are in place, so that will add substantial revenues for us. And from launch perspective, there are several ANDAs. I mean, not many like billion-dollar products out there. But products, we're launching so many molecules, is a mix of several products that's giving us this growth.
Okay, sure, sir. So lastly, earlier you had called out that a good part of supplies for enoxaparin will be shifting from innovator to Gland in FY22. So could you throw light on how meaningful this opportunity can be for the company in 22?
So we're expecting it to do it in the last quarter of this fiscal. That's an agreement. So we'll see a quarter of sale of this year, and then moving forward next few years.
Okay, sure, sir. That's it from my side, and all the best.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Ravi Naredi from Naredi Investments Private Limited. Please go ahead.
Sir, please tell about the CapEx plan. I could not hear properly for next 2 years.
Right. So for the next year, we indicated a capex of 300 crores.
Yes.
Next transmute investment in our Pashmedana facility, our API facility in Vizag and Onco facility in Vizag. And the year after that, FY23, we expect to spend about 200 crores.
200 crore, this and the 500 crore plan is there. And sir, the one thing is there, in last, in this pandemic time, most of the pharma companies margin has increased this year, but our margin is stable. So any specific reason for that?
So it all depends on, you know, product portfolio what we have, right? I mean, there's some companies where they struggle because they don't have the particular kind of a product. And some they do well if they have a set of products which are good for COVID. For us, like I always said, you know, we have a, the breadth of portfolio where we're not dependent on one or two products where, you know, good times it's very good, but then you also have bad times. So we have that balancing act. So we kind of continue to do it. If you look at, you know, whether it is within a year, seasonal changes won't impact us big way. And also year-wise, there's no big impact. So I would say that's one of the reasons we kind of maintain the stable business in terms of growth and margins.
Fine, fine. And sir, lastly, we have 3.39% of our R&D. So next few years, this will be the our base or something we are doing great in this R&D.
No, we continue. You know, if you look at our plan, the 5-year plan, it will be between 3 to 4% in terms of R&D expenditure, and the absolute number, of course, we are growing faster. So the absolute number is growing that fast, right? I mean, 30%, 30%, you're growing, or 25%, 27%. So your R&D expenditure is also growing that way. So the investments are increasing in terms of numbers.
Thank you very much, sir. You are doing great.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, that will be the last question for today. I will now hand the conference over to Mr. Sumanta Vajpayee for closing comments.
Thank you again, everyone, for joining us today. If any of the questions still remain unanswered, please feel free to get in touch with me. We will provide our feedback. Thanks. Stay safe. Good night.
Thank you very much. On behalf of Gland Pharma Limited, that concludes this conference. Thank you for joining us. You may now disconnect your lines. Thank you.